beginning of this period in 1940s or so, war was considered to be the normal way of humankind. I remember my parents always saying there will be war as long as we live. And strangely enough, in those 40 years, the number of countries who do not want to hear about war anymore, by considering this completely obsolete, has increased tremendously. Out of 159 nation states today, you have about 150 who live perfectly in peace with each other. They don't think of invading the next territory anymore. The borders are settled, that is accepted, no claims anymore. So that the number of actual conflicts or countries which are in conflict is very small, and the others pity them.
Robert Mueller is Assistant Secretary General of the United Nations. He was a member of the French Resistance in World War II, and for the last 37 years has devoted his life to international service through the United Nations. He is the author of A Planet of Hope, What War Taught Me About Peace, and most of all, They Taught Me Happiness. Today, he shares some of his central views on the quest for peace. A century ago, Alexis de Tocqueville talked about the competition he foresaw between the United States and the Soviet Union. And yet at this time we have no common borders. We have no interest in a nuclear war. It will serve no one's purpose. Why are the relations bad? What can be done about it?
Well, I think that at the time when the United Nations was created in 1945, the foundation of the United Nations was that the two big powers would cooperate. And then the Cold War came, the relations became pretty bad, and as a result, one of the main foundations of the UN crumbled. And this is why ever since we have had these conflicts from East and West Germany to Korea, all along the area where their borders touch. It is true that their physical borders are not in East Germany, in Berlin, and in Korea, but today they have allies on both sides, so that for all practical purposes you have a kind of territorial border between the zones of influence of the two big powers. And of course the new borders are outer space, they're the seas and the oceans, they're science and technology, so the whole political concept of what borders are on this planet has changed very fundamentally in the last 40 years.
In a career in the United Nations, which parallels that 40 years you just mentioned, you've had a chance to watch that relationship between the United States and the Soviet Union change and evolve. What have you learned from observing it?
Well, that the time will come when this will disappear too. Because in the first place, it is awfully costly for the planet. I think it is becoming so costly that I have the impression that the big powers are going to ruin themselves. Something is going to happen. Big powers have never existed forever. They've all disappeared in one form or another, and usually they disappear because they do not adapt themselves to the new requirements of the times and of evolution. The trouble is that when you're a big power, you are so contained in your power thinking that you cannot accept the idea that maybe the future could be different from the way in which you envisage it. So that therefore I think that both the United States and the Soviet Union will come to the realization that there has to be a change, because other alliances will take place around the world. You see the emergence of Japan, you see the emergence of China. Power is never completely stable. And I think that we have come after 40 years, it's about time for these two powers to sit down and to begin to talk as to how this planet could be better managed. Now people will tell you this will never come. But I've heard the same thing being from Alsace-Lorraine, where in my family I was always told the French and the Germans will never be friends. They're going to have war as long as the world exists. And in my grandfather's time, they had indeed three wars. But today, France and Germany are friends. They have created a common market. And I think the Soviet Union, United States, they could create common mechanisms, common endeavors for the planet, and then begin to reduce these wasteful expenditures on armaments and put it into very concrete things for humanity as a whole. This would be a beautiful adventure. As a matter of fact, you see, if from the day on both sides they begin to think in these positive terms, they will become very excited about it.
You wrote a book once about what you learned about peace from spending World War II in the middle of a lot of conflict.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
In writing that book, what were you trying to share?
Well, primarily that conflict has to be replaced by a cooperation. Nations are here to stay, they have their borders, they have their territories, but at the present moment we know our planet as being one unit for one human family, and this is the new age of cooperation that has to be started. And the same way as France and Germany buried their war hatchet and began to work together for the common of all Europe and even extra Europe, I think the same way the Soviet Union and United States are very intelligent countries, they could begin to cooperate. It would be beautiful.
What are the areas that the United States and the Soviet Union could cooperate on that would be easy to do so?
Well, for example, to look at the planet from an engineering point of view, to begin with. There are pipelines to build from Siberia to the United States via Alaska. That is one of the great projects which had been considered between the United States and the Soviet Union. It would create a certain interdependence. You can build canals. You can build new ports. You can exploit the hydroelectricity in the poor countries which have never been touched. In other words, to do things together instead of only putting this money into armaments and increase as a result of this the common interest they have one with the other.
What are the areas that will be the most difficult?
Well, the most difficult is, as usual, the field of the military. The military need to have someone to be suspicious of in order to justify their continuation. But even there, I believe that the proposal which was made by McCloy and Zorin years ago at the time of John Kennedy, if the military began to work together, as is provided for in the Charter, there was a military staff committee that was supposed to organize a world security system and then disarm. But with the Cold War, that was stopped. Now, if you would put the military again together in a world disarmament agency under the UN, which was the proposal of McCloy and Zorin, the military would be quite excited. They could work together to protect this planet from an outside invasion, to protect the planet from violences of any sorts, to protect the planet from terrorist groups or little splinter groups who begin to fabricate atomic bombs. For the military, it would be absolutely wonderful. As a matter of fact, in the law of the sea at the UN, we had the admirals work together, and to the great surprise of the diplomats, it was found that the admirals agreed much more readily with each other than the politicians. It is their profession, and once you get the professionals together, they find many ways of working together.
You've emphasized communications in an increasingly interdependent world. Where would you have the United States and the Soviet Union increase communications?
In my opinion, absolutely at the head of state level. You see, there are many proverbs in the world that say that you clean a staircase from the top to the bottom, the water doesn't flow uphill. In China, they say that the trouble always starts with the head, the fish begins to stink from the head. It is very essential that the heads get together. And I think that it is indispensable that when you have leaders like those of the United States and the Soviet Union, that before they criticize each other, before they slash at each other, they should at least know each other and visit each other's country.
You also believe the United Nations can play an important role in that, in getting them together in the context of the normal work of the UN.
Yes, you see, because there, here you don't need an agenda. You come for the General Assembly, that is the occasion. You don't have to pre-negotiate what you're going to discuss. You come to New York, as most of the ministers of foreign affairs do already, you stay here for a week, and then privately you see the other parties and you discuss a lot. The UN has done this for ministers of foreign affairs, and on the 40th anniversary of the UN, we did it also for the heads of states. Plenty of them came, and I think the heads of states who are in charge of managing the planet, they should know each other, know their reactions, they should telephone each other. Why do you send always an ambassador? You have the telephone today. We could have video systems in the president's room in Washington and in the Kremlin. And if he has a trouble developing, let's say, in Thailand or Afghanistan, it just switches on. He said, look, Mr. Gorbachev, what's happening over there? Probably Gorbachev would say, I have no idea. Let me try to find out. Mm-hmm. I think this is indispensable. Dialogue, knowing each other at the head of state level, is, in my opinion, one of the most important steps to promote world peace.
You also believe that there's provision for the Security Council to involve the heads of state. What kind of agenda would they have?
Well, for example, what I would envisage is that the Security Council, which is really the world's most important body for security, that instead of meeting only at the ambassadorial level and sometimes at the Minister of Foreign Affairs level, that the Security Council should go and have a meeting, let's say, in Moscow, have a meeting in Washington, have a meeting in Beijing, and have the heads of states come together on that occasion, know each other, and also be much closer to the public. I think the Security Council is too far removed from the public. If we were in Moscow or in those places, you would be closer to the public. We have done it on a number of occasions for the Panama Canal Treaty. The Security Council met in Panama City and really put the final touch to the solution between the United States and the Panamanians on the canal.
If you look over the 40-year history of the United Nations, what has it been able to accomplish in reducing the risks of war and settling wars that were going on?
Well, it has done enormously, but it has not done quite sufficiently either, because the world is in such a dangerous situation, because we emerge from our long history with 5,000 religions, with many, many languages, close to 5,000 also, 150 nation states with big territories, with small territories, people who believe that that system of living is better, other livings are better, the races, the black and the white, the rich and the poor, all this that lived a little bit in isolation from each other, all this came together very quickly after the Second World War, with science and technology promoting this, and this gave the possibility of dozens of world wars. 50 years ago, any category of this would have created a war. So that we have lived one of the most incredibly explosive periods in human history. And I think what the United Nations has helped to do, and the historians will recognize this someday, is that it has facilitated this transition to a point where now we can look at a better future. It has definitely helped avoid another world war. You see, here at least you have constant communications. At any moment of the day or the night, the Secretary General of the Security Council can get the parties together. Usually when they have a trouble, they throw each other's ambassador out, they don't recognize each other anymore. No talk, of course, then you have war. Here, there's always talk. Here we are a world telecommunication center, day and night, to get the opinions of every country on Earth by very fast telecommunication centers on any conflict that breaks out. And out of the about 200 conflicts which we had in the world since 1945, well, United Nations has solved over 100. And for those which still remain at the present time, they are all contained. Each one is under surveillance. Iraq and Iran, they might not want to make peace today, but the UN makes sure that it doesn't spill over into other territories. And that is important in itself. at the moment when you have all these dangerous.
What distinguishes those countries that are not involved in conflict from those that are?
Well, I think it has a lot to do about good economic conditions, a long history of civilization. I think the richer and more cultivated the country becomes, the less it is interested in war. This is one of the reasons why many of the conflicts are breaking out between very poor countries. They do not have as yet this maturity. They are at the state at which the United States was at its own independence and had its own war between the South and the North. They will require a little bit more time, but it's important for the UN then to make sure that this doesn't spill out into something bigger.
What role will economic development in the world have in the long-term search for an enduring peace?
Oh, definitely, definitely, because very often in these countries they resort to conflict out of despair.
Another area you've singled out is population, that the projections for the year 2000 have gone from over 7 billion to over 6 billion now. What role does population have in peace?
Yeah, well, you see, that one of the very interesting roles of the UN is that we didn't have any statistics about the world. We didn't even know how many people lived on this planet until the UN, the Economic and Social Council, asked for this to be done. So we found out that in 1951, for the first time, we gave the world a population figure which was 2.5 billion people. But then, since the children didn't die so quickly anymore because of health and hygiene, then a population explosion became apparent, which was detected only in about the years 1960. So the UN made long-term projections and said to the world, look, you're going to be in deep trouble if you continue. So we had world population conferences that are big drums telling the people, take it easy. And as a result of this, now the estimates of the world population for the year 2000 have gone down from 7.3 billion to 6.1 billion. That's one of the great successes of the UN. Now, population is something which we have to be very careful of at this stage of human evolution, because the mushrooming of a population in countries where they cannot respond to this increase of population is going to create such poverty that out of poverty you're going to have revolution and again war.
As you think ahead to what role that the United Nations can play and what role individual nation states can play creating a peaceful world, I'd like you to share your insights. First, what can nations do individually to create peace?
Well, I think that nations are now the territorial subdivisions of the planet. And I think that any nation that lives in peace with its neighbors, any nation that has good economic conditions, that has a good social justice, that has a good health for its people, that has a good educational system, that has minimal unemployment, that nation is contributing to the total health of the planet, to the total happiness of the planet and of humanity. So that this is the greatest contribution a nation can do. And therefore, it should also cooperate with the others and not create trouble with the others. So that the nation is a co-participant in the total peace of the planet. But it brings to the international community the peace and the happiness and the well-being and the justice and the kindness of its people.
When there's conflict between states, what role can the rule of law play?
Well, the rule of law is all in the United Nations Charter. You ought to resort to peaceful means of resolving your conflict. The Charter is a very perfect document from that point of view. The only problem is that once in a while a nation breaks the charter and takes its armies, invades the neighbor, and therefore does not accept the rules which it had solemnly pledged to obey when they became a member of the United Nations. That is the problem.
The United States is one of the countries that has from time to time decided that it won't submit certain conflicts to the world rule of law.
Yes, the United States has done it, the Soviet Union has done it, the major powers have been pretty good at doing it.
What has to happen to get more confidence that the rule of law, which serves so well internally, is a basis for some fair adjudication externally?
Well, I think that every head of state, as a matter of fact, when he swears to the Bible that he's going to uphold the law of the country, should be reminded that the Charter of the United Nations is part of the law of the country. From the moment the United Nations Charter was ratified by the United States, it became part of the statutes and laws of the United States. But many presidents, they do not even know that. They should be reminded. Maybe when the president takes an oath, next to the Bible, there should also be a Charter of the United Nations, so that he's reminded that he is entrusted with the faithful fulfillment of the obligations which the country has taken.
40 years into its history, the United Nations has been a significant force for peace. As you pointed out, roughly half of the conflicts that developed in that time were settled. How do you want to see the UN grow and evolve as a force for peace in the world?
I think the UN is here to stay. It will be more and more resorted to for the solution of conflicts. The only field in which it cannot say and do much is the relationship between the United States and the Soviet Union. And since these relationships are pretty bad at the moment, then United Nations declines a little bit in its importance. So that, as I said before, the US and the USSR are really the key. But for the rest, United Nations is now practically universal. It is dealing with practically every problem under the sun, including solar energy itself. It has 32 specialized agencies. It gives the world surveys on anything you can imagine, on children, on drugs, on deserts, on the ozonosphere, on the pollution of these oceans. I think this is the great role of the United Nations, and in my opinion, people should take a greater interest in it. There ought to be more education about United Nations and its specialized agencies, because they belong to the people. They're here to serve all the peoples of the world.
The United Nations doesn't have a direct role in the regulation of nuclear weapons. Is that a possible accomplishment?
Well, you see, the UN has guarded practically every peace program and regulatory program in the nuclear field you can imagine. We have, as you know, the International Atomic Energy Agency, which is entrusted with inspection and control of production and transport of nuclear material. The UN has made a proposal, for example, of a satellite of the UN that would control disarmament. You can picture everything on Earth. So we have a magnificent proposal put forth by the French and accepted by other nations, but unfortunately, so far, the United States and the Soviet Union have not approved it. So the UN is trying its best, but once you have big powers not accepting what the UN proposes, there's very little you can do, because the UN is powerless. It has none of the sovereignties of nations at all.
But it represents the common interests of humanity.
Yes, it is very, I would say that it is a very influential organization, because it expresses what is important for humanity as a whole and not only for individual nations. It's a new ethical form of saying humanity is important, the planet is important, let us work for a better humanity on a well-managed planet.
I'd like you to address your hopes for a UN disarmament agency.
Yes, I think that this could do enormously, because what I've observed in the UN is that from the moment you bring people together to work in the new agencies, everything changes. From the moment you got the ministers of health to work in the World Health Organization, and at the beginning they didn't want to hear of it, now you couldn't suppress the organization. They have their common health policies, they've decided to eradicate smallpox, which has been done, which saves governments $2 billion a year, which reduces the number of blind people in India by 50%. It is so beautiful what you can do when you get people in the same profession to come together. So in all these agencies, in food, in agriculture, in education, they come together and they're quite excited about it, because beyond their own nations, they can do something as ministers of health for the entire world. Now, if we did this for the military, it would be as exciting. From the moment they would be sitting in certain committees, for example, to study, the first thing which I would ask them to study is to really, before anything else, to reduce the risk of nuclear accidents to as little as possible. Because the more we have missiles, the more we are in the hands of the computers. If one of these things gets off, it is not a telephone call between Moscow and the United States that's going to solve the problem. We'll be too late. We will become the slaves of the computers. The computers, they will continue. Nobody will be able to stop it. So that if we could only get the military to sit down and say, well, how can we reduce, as a first step, the danger of a nuclear war by accident, by computer error, if we could do this, they would do it. And then you can expand it on the controls of the seas and the oceans, disarmament. But you would have to have them sit together in an agency to have the admirals and the generals see each other, chiefs of staff. And as they would be together, they would find it very exciting to begin to control the world militarily rather than to sit in the Pentagon, in the Kremlin, be suspicious of each other and invent all kinds of dangers which in reality do not exist.
I'd like to close by asking you to return to a theme that runs throughout your writings, and that is that of hope, and ask you to share your vision for the world as the 21st century begins.
I think that we will enter the next century, the next millennium, as we have entered the earlier millennia. In other words, always a great mixture of hope and despair. You remember that we entered the year 1000. There was a pest all over the world. The people were dying in the churches, and everybody thought it would be the end of the world. It wasn't the end of the world. And then they built the beautiful cathedrals as a gesture of thanks to God. This time we will still have many scares. I think it's mostly the scare of a nuclear holocaust, which is the scare of the human species. But on the other hand, there is so much hope around. There are so many people working at it around the world that, in my opinion, we will succeed. And now we have to sit down and to work harder on making it possible. I can tell you very frankly that when I came after the Second World War as a young man to the United Nations, I had very little hope in the future. I said to myself at the age of 27, if France and Germany had three wars during my grandfather's lifetime, if my father was once a German and a French soldier, if my cousins were in German uniforms and others were in French uniforms, if these two nations couldn't make it, how can I expect the world to make it? Impossible. I thought that was in 20 years we would have another world war. And strangely enough, it's not true. Because in the meantime, I have seen humanity take conscious of its future. Peace today is the rule. It is no longer war that is the rule. War is the exception. The discussion already is going from peace to disarmament. It is armaments which are the most frightful thing. It is not so much war anymore. The risks of war are pretty limited at the present moment. So that I think that we hope, as a matter of fact, is very essential, because we are a very complex species on a complex planet, and in order to solve our problems, we have to hope. I think all life is hope. Without hope, life is meaningless.
Dr. Muller, thank you for sharing with us today your hopes for a world at peace in the 21st century.